Hi, this is an electron gene expression from DNA to protein, which can be found in course documents folder from DNA to protein. So in this lecture, we're going to talk about gene expression and DNA code and how do you transcribe DNA sequence to RNA and RNA to protein. As we said earlier, human genome contains both non-coding DNA and coding DNA. And coding DNA represents only a small part of the genome, about 1.5%, and consists of about 20,000 different genes. And the coding part of the genome is known as exome. So much of the exome controls protein synthesis, and the genes, 20,000 genes code for 20,000 different types of protein. So proteins play diverse functions in the human body. Some proteins act like enzymes. Some proteins are important in communication, for example, receptor proteins, such as an example would be ACE2 receptor that we talked about in this class. Some proteins are important in structure, some are important in transport, and some are important in movement. And this slide just shows you kind of the five different functions of proteins. You don't have to know or memorize this slide. This is just to explain that proteins are really crucial for performing all kinds of functions important for cellular function and for cellular maintenance. Okay, so this is just some examples of diverse functions of proteins in the human body. So, for example, actin, myosin, and dystrophin are important in muscle contraction. Antigens, antibodies, and cytokines are important in the immune system response. Collagen, elastin, and fibrillin are found in the connective tissue. Later on in the course, we'll see how mutations in some of these genes coding for example, fibrillin can lead to genetic disease such as Marfan syndrome. DNA and RNA polymerases are important because they allow for DNA replication and RNA transcription and RNA synthesis, respectively. So DNA polymerase synthesizes DNA and RNA polymerase synthesizes RNA. Erythropoietin has become recently, it was recently very popular in the news because of blood doping, because this protein can stimulate the production of red blood cells in the body, and that was used by some athletes, and we'll talk about that later on in the course. When we talk about cancer genetics, you will see that proteins such as kinases are very important in cell division and in driving cell cycle. And when those enzymes called kinases are mutated, that can ultimately lead to cancer. We will also talk about tumor suppressor proteins, which are important in cell cycle regulation, and they protect us from cancer. So when tumor suppressor genes are mutated, they produce non-functional tumor suppressor proteins, and as a result, that can also lead to cancer. An example would be a mutation in a gene coding for P53 protein. And when P53 protein is mutated and when it doesn't work, that can lead to cancer. Okay, hemoglobin is important for oxygen transport, and we will talk about a number of genetic diseases, including beta and alpha thalassemia and sickle cell anemia, where there is a mutation in hemoglobin gene, which codes for hemoglobin, and you will see the effect that it has on human organism and well-being. Okay, so moving on, how do we know about this connection between genes and proteins? How do we know that a gene codes for protein? So some clues came from the research by Archibald Garrett. The experiments were done in the late 19th century from about 1890 to 1910. And another team of researchers named Biddle and Tatum, who were doing these experiments on bread mold called Neurospora in the 1970s. So both of those studies established the link between genes, proteins, and phenotype. So first I wanted to talk about Archibald Garrett. I wanted to focus today on Archibald Garrett's study because it's important also for our human genetics and human inheritance course. So Archibald Garrett was interested in studying pediatric diseases, and he also had an interest in studying helping patients with arthritis. He was a British physician and a biochemist. And he was also a fellow of the Royal Society of London. Normally, people are nominated to be in this society if they made an important contribution to sciences and medicine and just anything that has to do with natural and applied sciences. So Archibald Garrett in 1897 was working in a hospital in England, in London, and the woman showed up with a baby, and she said that her baby has black nappies. So nappies, this is how they called diapers. So she noticed that when her baby would pee, the diaper would turn brown or black in color. So this was really puzzling, and Archibald Garrett was, you know, the physician who was monitoring the baby. And, you know, he asked the lady to give him some family history and tell him if there were any other members of the family who had this same issue. And it turned out that they had a few people in the family who had that. And later on, she became pregnant with another child, and again, when the child was born, Archibald Garrett asked the mom and the nannies to monitor, you know, that change of urine, to look at the nappies, at the diapers. And 52 hours after the second baby was born, again, they found that the baby had black urine that turned black. So Archibald Garrett knew about this disease. It was called alkaptonuria. And he started making a pedigree for this family. And he also was familiar with the work of Mendel, Gregor Mendel, on units of inheritance. And he started seeing that there's an inheritance pattern. Moreover, he realized it's an autosomal inheritance pattern, meaning that you needed, that it skipped a generation and you needed to inherit at least two copies of a mutant gene to get the disease. At the time, he didn't know about genes, but he just noted that this disease skipped a generation, and he noted that it was a heritable trait. So he realized it had something to do with units of inheritance called genes. And then he was also a biochemist, so he was looking at the biochemical pathway of, you know, how urine is produced, and he was also looking at the tyrosine and phenylalanine, and the phenylalanine and tyrosine pathway, an amino acid called phenylalanine gets converted to L-DOPA and a number of other substances. And this is also, you can see, connected to the citric acid cycle. So in alkaptonuria, there was a block. There was an enzyme called homochitic acid oxidase, which was not functioning. So this enzyme was not working, and as a result, there was an accumulation of this brown pigment. He called that pigment alkapton. And now we know that it's homogenistic acid. That's just another name for it. And so basically, because of the accumulation of that pigment, there was also accumulation. Also, you can see that when this pathway is not functioning properly in another disease called albinism, there's another enzyme called tyrosinase, which is not functioning. And as a result, melanin is not produced. So it's kind of the opposite. Here, the melanin is not made in albinism. But in alkaptonuria, there's an accumulation of pigment, which when exposed to air, makes the urine appear brown or black. So he looked at this biochemical issue and he realized that there must be some sort of inheritable issue which is affecting a gene. And this gene must somehow be connected to this enzyme. So a gene must code for this enzyme. Now, he didn't say code. He just said that there was a link between a gene involved in alkaptonuria and an enzyme involved in the same pathway. So he really established this link and he called it an inborn error of metabolism. So this is something you guys should know for the course. So an inborn error of metabolism is when there is a mutation in a gene that codes for an enzyme important in the metabolic pathway. And this mutation is going to affect the function of that enzyme and it's going to interfere with that metabolic pathway and lead to a genetic disease. So if you see a case study on the test or if we discuss it in class and there's a family who have some kind of metabolic syndrome and there's a mutation in the gene encoding a certain enzyme, this is when you know that this disease can be classified as inborn errors of metabolism. Alkaptonuria is an example of inborn errors of metabolism. So moving on, I also said that Biddle and Tatum worked on bread mold neurospora, and what they found was that when they mutated certain genes important in vitamin B pathway by exposing bread mold to radiation, they mutated certain genes, and they saw that it really affected enzymes in the vitamin B pathway, and this is how they also established a link between genes and proteins. And this was done in 1970s after they already knew that DNA can code for proteins. And this was a confirmation of the results that Archibald Garrett derived from his experiments. Gene expression, so to better understand gene expression, so first of all, what does it mean when a gene is expressed? So when a gene produces mRNA and when a gene produces protein, that's when we say that the gene is expressed. So if a gene synthesizes a certain amount of mRNA, a measurable amount of mRNA, we say that the gene is expressed. Okay. And gene levels of gene expression may vary. So some, for example, osteocalcin gene might be highly expressed in bone cells. So you might detect a high level of mRNA production or mRNA being expressed. And then if you measured protein, you would see high levels of osteocalcin protein being produced. But if you looked at osteocalcin gene expression in liver cells, you will see low levels of mRNA and low levels of protein being produced. So you would see much lower levels of osteocalcin gene expression in liver. So now I want to talk about central dogma of molecular biology, which really describes the flow of genetic information and how genes are expressed. So first of all, DNA normally has to be replicated or copied. So this is not a part of central dogma. This is just to say that when cells divide, DNA has to be replicated and distributed to daughter cells. Okay, so DNA replication is separate from this. But the central dogma of biology is quite simple. It says that DNA makes RNA and RNA makes protein. So DNA makes RNA through a process called transcription. And RNA makes protein through a process called translation. So you might wonder, why does it say RNA and not mRNA? And what is mRNA? mRNA is known as messenger RNA because it's a message encoded from the information contained in DNA. So sometimes you would see that it says m, like a little m next to RNA. So it just says messenger RNA or mRNA. It doesn't matter, you know, we can just say RNA or mRNA. But, you know, mRNA would be more accurate. Okay, so again, DNA makes RNA through a process called transcription, and RNA makes protein through a process called translation. Now, replication and transcription occur in the nucleus of the cell, and translation occurs in the cytoplasm of the cell outside of the nucleus. So when RNA is synthesized, it has to exit the nucleus, it has to get edited, and then it exits the nucleus, and that's where it gets translated into protein. So here again, we're looking at this flow of genetic information, and this is the central dogma of molecular biology. I don't like the word dogma because, you know, it sounds like something that should not be disproven, which is always correct. And this is ultimately not the case, but it's just something that we call it because it's such an important concept. So we have DNA made up of repeating units called nucleotides, and there are four flavors of nucleotides, A, T, C, and G. And through a process of transcription, it gets a small portion of RNA, so a particular gene can get transcribed into RNA. And then RNA has to be edited by a process called RNA processing. So imagine kind of like in a company, if you have a product, before you can sell it, you have to, you know, put marketing materials in the box, you have to package it, you have to prepare it for shipment. So this is like RNA processing. And then, so in this case, we'll talk about this later, but during RNA processing, all the non-coding RNA pieces known as introns have to be removed or excised, and all the coding pieces of RNA called exons, they remain and they get shuffled together and ligated together into a mature RNA transcript. And after RNA processing, RNA also gets a cap, so a modified G nucleotide placed at the 5' prime end of RNA, and an RNA tail, like a poly A tail made of A nucleotides added to the 3' prime end. Again, don't worry about this for now. We'll come back to RNA processing. So RNA gets all processed, and then it leaves the nucleus and goes in the cytoplasm. And now it's a mature mRNA, messenger RNA. And then it gets translated into protein. And protein is made of amino acids. And there are 20 different types of amino acids. So depending on the mRNA code, you would insert a particular amino acid corresponding to that mRNA code, and you would synthesize your protein. So the enzymes involved in transcription is called RNA polymerase, and a number of players or RNAs participating in translation are called ribosomes and transfer RNA. So we'll talk about those molecules, or those specific molecules that have RNA, different types of RNA molecules which have enzymatic function, and they are actually involved in translation. Okay, so we'll come back to that concept. Okay, so the most important thing for you is just to know that DNA makes RNA and RNA makes protein. Note that I did not say DNA is made into RNA, because DNA makes RNA. It actually provides information which is used by RNA polymerase to synthesize the RNA molecule. So an analogy here would be like, imagine you have a big book and it has a lot of information, so that's your human genome, and you want to just transcribe a particular passage. So you take out your laptop and you're just typing up some paragraph from the book. So this is like transcription, where you have a human genome which has a lot of information and you just want to transcribe a particular gene. So you're just making mRNA corresponding to that gene. You're not transcribing the whole genome at once. You're just transcribing a small portion corresponding to that specific genetic sequence, that specific gene. And translation is like going from one language to another. So you have a language of nucleic acids, and you are translating that into the language of amino acids. So you have a bunch of special molecules which are going to be involved in this process, and they will hold a molecule of mRNA, and they will bring in the appropriate amino acid which corresponds to the code in the mRNA sequence and put those amino acids together in the chain. And later on, that amino acid chain will fold and will actually form a protein. Okay, so let's go to the next level. And so the question is, how does RNA and DNA code for a particular phenotype, like a certain trait that we might see in, for example, in a human being? So how does RNA code for physical, emotional, and behavioral traits? And this is something we will be discovering in this course. We will have a lot of examples where you will see how a mutation in a certain DNA gene sequence can alter the protein code and how that can have an impact on the phenotype. So I said that, you know, I didn't like saying central dogma, because dogma is something that's irrefutable and it doesn't sound like science, because in science we always do more research and more studies, and we are constantly disputing what we knew before, and we find more information to dispute things and then to find support for things that we knew from the past. So, you know, here we have again the central dogma: DNA makes mRNA and mRNA makes protein. But it turns out that in retroviruses, you can go the opposite way. You can take mRNA and convert it back to DNA. And this is kind of like the paradigm shift of central dogma. And so what does this mean? So it turns out that retroviruses like HIV and Ebola virus, they have an enzyme called reverse transcriptase, known as RT. And reverse transcriptase can convert mRNA to cDNA or complementary DNA. So if you take mRNA and you make it into double-stranded DNA, but you have to remember that mRNA only has the coding sequences, because it's a mature mRNA. It doesn't have any non-coding sequences called introns. So the DNA molecule that you make from mRNA would be significantly shorter than the genomic DNA. So genomic DNA has non-coding and coding DNA. So it has introns and exons. And the type of DNA that you would get from mRNA, it would have only the coding parts to it. So we'll come back to this again when we specifically talk about RT-PCR. And RT-PCR is a very useful technique in the lab, which allows you to measure gene expression. So in RT-PCR, you are collecting patients' total mRNA, and then you convert that mRNA to cDNA or complementary DNA. And then you can use PCR reaction or polymerase chain reaction to measure the amount of cDNA. And that will ultimately tell you how much mRNA of that particular gene was produced, okay? And this will help you understand how much, what are the levels of expression of that gene. So just to review again, DNA and RNA, what are the differences? So DNA is usually double-stranded and RNA is usually single-stranded. DNA has thymine as a base and RNA has uracil. DNA has deoxyribose as sugar and RNA has ribose as sugar. DNA maintains protein coding information. It codes for proteins. RNA can also, RNA obviously codes for protein as well, but you have different types of RNA. You have mRNA, which codes for protein, and you also have other types of RNA that we will be talking about in this course, such as transfer RNA and ribosomes like rRNA, ribosomal RNA, and microRNA, and short interfering RNA. So you have other types of RNA. Okay, and DNA cannot function as an enzyme, and RNA actually has some enzymatic activity, so some forms of RNA can actually function as an enzyme. DNA persists, it's very stable, it's a double helix, and RNA is unstable and transient. So here again, this is just going over the same thing. You can see DNA is double-stranded, which makes it stable. It can be replicated through DNA replication. RNA contains protein coding information. It makes proteins. It's generally single-stranded and it can form loops. It can loop onto itself and forms interesting structures. DNA has deoxyribose, RNA has ribose. And you remember that carbon number 2 in DNA has the H and carbon number 2 in ribose has the OH, hence it's called deoxyribose. D is a prefix, means to remove something. So here we are removing oxygen. That's why it's called deoxyribose. And these are the bases, again, used in DNA and RNA. So remember that the nucleotides have a sugar, a phosphate group, and a base. And if you wanted to say full name of a base for DNA, for example, for adenine, it would be DATP or deoxyadenosine triphosphate or DATP. So D for deoxyribose, A for adenosine triphosphate because it has three phosphate groups. Deoxyadenosine triphosphate. Why do we say adenosine and not adenine? Because we have the N-O-S-I-N-E ending, because it's attached to a sugar. So if you wanted to say a base for RNA, this would be ATP or adenosine triphosphate. Okay, so now we can move on to transcription. Transcription is a process by which RNA is synthesized. So one thing you have to remember about transcription is for the transcription to occur, we will go into the mechanism in more detail. Transcription, proteins called transcription factors have to assemble on the gene's promoter, which is a segment right next to the gene. Usually at the 5' end of the gene, there is a segment called promoter. So proteins called transcription factors will assemble on the promoter, and they will recruit an enzyme called RNA polymerase, and this enzyme will synthesize the mRNA. Now, one thing you have to remember, transcription uses 3 to 5' end as a template. So this 3 to 5' end is used as a template always. And the new strand, the mRNA strand, is going to be 5' to 3'. So mRNA is always 5' to 3'. So if you're doing a problem on the test and it asks you to transcribe mRNA, so suppose I gave you a DNA sequence like AACG, AACG, and this is a 5' to 3' RNA sequence. Well, let's just take this one here. So we have 5' to 3' sequence ACA, TCG, ACG, CGCA. So the mRNA will also be 5 to 3. So the mRNA will be exactly the same as the 5 to 3' strand, except that instead of T's, you have U's. So if you have to transcribe DNA to RNA, all you do is you take the DNA 5 to 3' sequence, you substitute T's for U's, and you are done. A longer way of doing that would be to take 3 to 5 as a template. So you would take T, G, T, A, G, C, T, G, C, G, C, G, T, and then you would just start transcribing. So you would say T, the opposite of T is A, the opposite of G is T, the opposite of T is A, the opposite of A is U, the opposite of G is C, and then you would get this top strand, except instead of T's, you would have U's. So there's a longer way of doing that, and there's a shorter way of doing it. Again, the shortcut is to take the 5 to 3 strand of DNA and change T's to U's. So this is showing you exactly the same thing here. We have the coding strand of DNA known as this is the 5 to 3 strand, and it's known as the top strand. It's known as the coding strand. It's also known as the sense strand. 3 to 5 strand is known as the template strand, as the bottom strand, and as the antisense strand. So the template strand serves as a template for transcription. So you can see the mRNA strand is the same as the 5 to 3 or the sense or the coding strand. And so it's going to be exactly identical, except T's are substituted for U's. Okay? So we call it the coding strand or the sense strand because it's the strand that ultimately specifies the amino acid sequence. So this code here is going to be read by the ribosomes and by the transfer RNA to, specifically by the transfer RNA to, and transfer RNAs will bring the appropriate amino acids corresponding to this code here. Okay, so again, we said that there were two types of nucleic acids, RNA and DNA, and they both consist of sequences of nitrogen-containing bases and sugar-phosphate backbones. And so the question is, how do we go from the RNA code, which is this GACU, so you have 4 bases, how do we go from this code to protein code, which is made of amino acids? You can see that amino acid structure is quite different than DNA or RNA nucleotide structure. They look very different than RNA nucleotides. So how do you go from this code to this code? And just to think about it as cracking the code. Imagine yourself for a second as a crypto analyst, as breaking the code. And we have some examples of this crypto analysis. For example, in World War II, there was a brigade of Native American soldiers, and they specifically, these soldiers, they knew their native language, Navajo language, and this is one of the only languages which was not written down prior to World War II. So it was a great language to use for code because there was no like written record of it. And there was a brigade led specifically by Marines General Clayton Vogel and Philip Johnston. And Japanese had very hard time decoding the code from this brigade of Marines. And it really helped the United States during World War II. This brigade was honored multiple times by Pentagon. There was a movie made about them, if you're interested, and a very inspiring movie about their contribution. And also, there was recently, they were honored again by President Trump and the current administration and the Pentagon. And there were some negative things that were said in the media about the ceremony, but overall, it's really great that these men were honored for their contribution during World War II. Alan Turing was another, this is another example of crypto analysis and cryptography. Alan Turing was a brilliant mathematician, brilliant British mathematician, and he was a crypto analyst, and he's known as the father of the modern computer science and artificial intelligence. And famously, he worked on deciphering the codes, breaking the codes by the Nazis. So Nazis had this Enigma machine, which they used to sort of encode their messages so that the Allied forces didn't know what they were planning. And Polish researchers came up with this machine called the Bomba, which used mathematical analysis to break Nazi codes. But Alan Turing actually modified the Bomba and he created his own machine, and he was able to decipher those messages. And, they credit his work. His work was very important in helping Allied forces defeat the Nazis and defeat the Nazi Germany and defeat fascism. He helped save a lot of lives. And sadly, he was persecuted because of his homosexuality at the time. In Britain, there were some homophobic laws, kind of like blue book laws. And he committed suicide at the age of 41. Interestingly, if you own an Apple iPhone, and you know how there's a symbol of a bitten off apple, like the apple is missing a piece, and they're saying that this is a shout out to Alan Turing because he really is known as the father of the modern computer science. And the reason why this apple is a connection to Alan Turing, because he passed away from taking a bite from an apple poisoned with cyanide. And there's a great movie about Alan Turing called The Imitation Game. So the genetic code was solved by researchers in the 1960s. And so how do you go from the language of nucleotides to the language of amino acids? Imagine what if we said that each nucleotide codes for a specific amino acid. So, for example, G codes for phenylalanine, A codes for leucine, U codes for proline, and C codes for cysteine. As you can see, this wouldn't work because you would have only four amino acids and we have 20. So what if you said that we would just take each two nucleotides would code for a specific amino acid, so a combination of two nucleotides. For example, GU codes for alanine and GA codes for leucine and UC codes for tyrosine. So if you wanted to express that as a mathematical formula for probability, you would have four possible combinations of nucleotides to the power of two, because you have two bases coding for an amino acid. So that would be 4 to the power of 2, which equals 16. And again, we don't have enough amino acids. Now, if you wanted to suppose you said it's actually a multiple of 3, as I'm sure you can see in this table, it kind of gives away the answer. So if it's 3 bases coding for one amino acid, you would do 4 to the power of 3, which ends up being 64, which is more than enough. So this would work for us. And in fact, a researcher named Nirenberg in the 60s, he did an experiment where he took long stretches of DNA that coded, of RNA that coded for UUU, and he found that each of those UUU, like 3 UUUs, coded for phenylalanine. So he later received the Nobel Prize for providing this experimental evidence and solving this puzzle of how DNA code can be translated into protein code. So basically, again, it's a free base code where free bases code for a specific amino acid. There are synonyms in the table. So if you look at this table, you will see that, for example, amino acid proline can be coded by 4 different codons, by 4 CCU, CCC, CCA, CCG, and those are known as synonymous codons because if you look at position 3 in the codon, it's changed. So it's always changing like CCU, CCC, CCA, and CCG. However, the nucleotides at position 1 and 2 remain the same. So those codons where the position number 3 is changed, but they all code for the same amino acid, those codons are known as synonymous codons. Codons that code for different amino acids are known as non-synonymous codons. Also in the table, you notice that there is a start codon, AUG, which codes for amino acid methionine. So all proteins on Earth start with methionine. AUG is known as a start codon. Another thing that you will notice in the table that there are stop codons. So only 61 codons code for particular amino acid. The other 3 codons are known as stop codons. They don't actually code for anything. They just tell the translational machinery to stop synthesizing the protein. And we have 3 stop codons, UAA, UGA, and UAG. So here's the table, and you can kind of see it better, and you can see the stop codons, and you can see the start codon. What if AUG appears somewhere in the middle of the RNA transcript? That means that it just codes for methionine. So if it's the first AUG that you see, that would be the start codon. But if it appears later on somewhere, that just means it's one of the amino acids in that protein, okay? So it's one of the codons coding for a specific amino acid. In that case, it would be methionine. Sometimes an RNA transcript can have alternative start site. So you could have two versions of the same transcript, a longer version and a shorter version. So if AUG appears several times, you might imagine that there might be two different versions of the transcript. We don't quite understand why in certain tissues one version might be preferred over a different version. And this is what also attributes to the variety of proteins that we see, in addition to other things such as splicing, and I'll talk about that later on, okay? So, again, just to repeat myself, genetic code is a triplet code. Three successive mRNA bases form a codon. Each codon codes for a specific amino acid. There are 64 different codons. There are 65 codons that code for a specific amino acid, and there are three stop codons. And also, I wanted to show you something. So if you look at this table, it's redundant because you have sometimes four different codons code for the same amino acid, like in the case of proline or serine or threonine. So if you look at proline or you look at threonine or serine, okay? But if you look at this table, it's not ambivalent, because what it means is that if a codon codes for proline, it can never code for a different amino acid. So a codon always codes for just one amino acid. It can never code for more than one. So the table is redundant, but not ambivalent. Okay. And so here is an example of how you would translate DNA to RNA. I mean, you would transcribe DNA to RNA, and this is an example of how RNA can be translated into amino acids. So here you have a specific sequence, and it can be divided into triplets called codons. So AAG codes for lysine, UCA codes for serine, GUC codes for valine. So let's talk about the rules of translation. This is what you really need, practically need for the test. So the first rule of translation, always find the start codon. The second rule, establish the reading frame, and then finally find the stop codon. So let me give you an example. Suppose you have a DNA sequence like AAA, CA, TG, GGG, CTC, TAA. And the question says, what is the mRNA sequence? Now we have to remember that mRNA sequence is always 5-3. So it's going to be exactly identical to this 5-3 DNA strand, which is known as the sense or the coding strand. So it's going to be exactly identical, except that you have to remember to change T's to use. So the RNA sequence is going to be AAA, CAUG, GGG, CUC, UAA. The next question says, translate that to amino acid sequence of the protein. So the first rule is find the start codon. A common mistake made by students is they start to translate the sequence right away. So they will say, okay, I have triplets. I have to break this into triplets. So they start saying, okay, AAA. They look up the amino acid, CAU, GGG, GCU, CAA. So they just go right ahead and they translate without finding the start codon first. So you have to remember that we want to find the start codon first. So in this case, it's the AUG, okay? So find the start codon AUG, and now establish the reading frame by underline, you know, the codons. So here we have AUG, GGG is the second codon. The third one is CUC. And UAA is the next one. Step three says find the stop codon. And here we found the stop codon, which happens to be UAA. So the amino acid sequence is met. And you can go back to the table and look up the rest of them. And I already did that. So, you know, it's met, glycine, leucine, and then you get the stop codon. In some tables, you will see that amino acids are shown as a triplet, kind of like methglyl. They kind of give you a shorthand for their long names. So, for example, methionine is meth and glycine is gly. But in some tables, amino acids are shown as single letters. So methionine is M and glycine is G and leucine is L. So if I give you a table with a single letter amino acid code, just make sure that you match it up to whatever the codon is, and you can find the appropriate single letter amino acid corresponding to that codon. So here's another example of a sequence being translated. So you have an mRNA, a DNA sequence, and you can see that mRNA is going to be the same as the 5-to-3 strand, because 3-to-5 strand of DNA is the antisense strand, and it serves as a template. So mRNA is the same as 5-to-3, except that you have to change T's to U's, and then you can translate it. Okay, and so I'm going to stop right here, and I've attached a specific exercise. It's like a handout where I'm asking you to transcribe DNA into RNA and then translate RNA into protein. And please complete that and bring that to class, and we will go over it. You don't have to submit that on Blackboard. You can submit that at the end of the day on Thursday, when we see each other on Thursday, and we'll go over this handout, and then you can go ahead and submit that. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for listening. Have a nice weekend. Bye.